And that leaves me for the exciting announcement of our first female leader and keynote speaker of the day, Miriam de Bleekwoer. Miriam is a partner at Baker McKenzie. She's also a member of the Dutch Senate, and she's written a book called Vrijgevochten, which means free-spirited in English. She's achieved a lot in her career, including being named Best Female Employment Lawyer of Europe multiple times. However, like many other women, she had to fight for her way to the top and even break the glass ceiling on her way there. She'll be here today to teach us about all the things that she has learned and to tell her story. So Miriam, I want to welcome you to the stage and thank you for joining us.
Thanks, Merle. Thank you.
Hi, Miriam.
Much.
Welcome.
Hello. Thank you very much. And Merle, thank you for giving me the floor. Thank you for doing an excellent job, because I know this was the first time for you to speak to such a broad audience.
Yes.
And you did a perfect job. You stepped out of your comfort zone. And I know that is always a bit scary, but so congratulations. You did it as an excellent speaker.
Thank you so much.
Then I would like to thank the audience to be there. It's very, very different than a year ago. I'm here in my kitchen since a year. You can see my kitchen, and I've been here for a year, and the whole world has changed. Sometimes for the better, sometimes for the worse, because I would really have loved to see you all and see the audience and be a bit more interactive than we can be today. But the good thing is that I'm now almost an IT professional, because I know how to share my screen, how to get backstage, and now this. So I'm very happy that this that I'm here and you can all hear me and see me. So I thought how to do this in a virtual world. You looking at me and my kitchen would be a bit dull, I think. So I thought it would be nice to share some photos with you, and sometimes a photo says more than 1,000 words. So Merle and I will be it will be a joint effort. So Merle will do the photos, and I will tell about the photos, and hopefully you will be inspired, and do ask questions in the chat if you feel like asking questions.
Yes.
So again, my name is Miriam de Bleekwoer. I've achieved a lot, as Merle explained. Thank you for that. But I'm also a mother. And I think that's important to say, and I'll come to that later. But we shouldn't forget about that. And a wife as well, and a sister. So let's start with that. How did I grow up? This is me. I think I'm five or four, some that age. I grew up with two younger sisters. We had dogs, cats, rabbits, ducks. I had a pony, and we even had a little pig. We were always playing in the garden. We didn't have internet or Xboxes or whatever, so we were always in the garden. And we all went to a free-spirited, it's called the Kees Boekenschool in Bilthoven. And I've learned a lot there, that it's not only about learning a lot, like reading books and knowing how to count and calculate and different know all, everything you learn from books, but that it's also important to interact with people and not forget to have fun with each other. So that's what I learned there. So I encourage you to not forget to also have fun. My parents had an old people house in the center of Holland, and we lived next to it. There were people who were very ill. Some were very old, others were very ill. And as a young kid, as you can see on the photo, I was there a lot. And I learned a lot from the older, but also the people who were very, very ill. And what I've learned from a young age is that if people are ill or old, what do they talk about? Do they talk about their careers? Do they talk about what they've achieved, big cases they won, all the board memberships they had? No, they talk about their family. That's what they talk about. Their brothers, their sisters, their parents, their children. So I've learned from a very young age on, I can achieve anything I would like to do, but I should cherish my family and friends. And yeah, so that is another lesson I've learned from a young age, and I want you to keep that in mind. When I was 19 years old, my mother got pregnant from my father, the same. This is already my student time, that's Leiden. But it's a bit dull to look at the same photo, but it's a nice story, because when I was 19 years old, I got a baby brother. And so we are 19 years time different, in age difference. But he's my best friend. He moved to Africa to live in Joburg with his family. And so I worked a lot from our Johannesburg office in Africa. And why do I tell this story? Because the story tells what it taught me, that whatever you do, so I worked a lot in Africa, that was more coincidence, but then things will follow from that. So now I'm in the African Parks board, and I lead I'm a co-leader in the leadership team of our Joburg office. So that learns you that don't think, oh, I'm asked to do this, let me not do it because I'm not an expert. It's not important. Just do it, jump, step out of your comfort zone, and something will come from it. Then we go to the Leiden time. So I chose to study in Leiden. And these are one of the of my best friends from Leiden. We lived in the same student house in Leiden at the Rapenburg, and we were in the same like small club of 25 girls, and they are still my best friends. So what that learns is that cherish your friends and be faithful to your friends. We still so the tallest one, she lives in Malta. She's a professional sailor. She sails the world, but she was in my kitchen like a few weeks ago. We don't see each other a lot, but when we see each other, it's always like we've seen each other just an hour before. You maybe wouldn't recognize me, but I'm the one next to her. And then there's Nadine. She lives in London, and there's Sita, and she's a professional coach. We had lots of fun. We live with 48 girls in a student house. That taught me to be flexible. It's important if you want a job, but even in your family, to always be flexible. Not always want to make your point. You know, you can make your point at a certain time if it's very important. But sometimes it's easy to be a bit flexible. It makes you an easier going person, and it brings you further in life, I think. So we had lots of fun, but I was very focused. I thought, I'm here to study. I want to, I'm here to study, so I will study. That was my line of life. So I graduated twice. And here is so civil law and tax law. This is the graduation for tax law. And at the back, you see a few of the 48 girls from where I lived with and in the student house. And as you can see, times were different. We could stand very close to each other, and the room was very crowded. Then the next photo is my family at my graduation party. There you can see my mother, my father, my little brother. You see him there, and his present for my graduation. I already liked fashion magazines, and you can see that my sister and I don't look like each other at all, but we have exactly the same voice, so they always hear when we are around. They say, hey, you must be a sister of Miriam. So my one sister doesn't work. She's a housewife. She's perfectly happy and never complains, which makes her a nice person to be around with. The other sister on the far right is a real estate broker. She is in real estate, works. My brother is one of the leaders in Kraft Heinz, and we work next to each other on the Zuidas. And so we're still, my family lives all at the same street in Bosendaan. For Nanette, who is a real estate broker, and she lives in Bussum. But it was very, very easy that we all lived at the same street, because our children always had somewhere to go one way or the other when I was busy at work. I joined Baker McKenzie, and why did I join Baker McKenzie? Because I talked with a friend of my father, and he said, well, you can combine tax law and civil law at Baker McKenzie. And this was the founder of Baker McKenzie in Amsterdam. His name is Willem Stevens. I just joined there. It was the first Christmas party. And Willem Stevens is still a good friend and was even present at my maiden speech in the Senate. So that also, he is one of my role models. I have a few role models, male and female, but he was already in the Senate when I joined Baker. And I always looked at him and thought, okay, how is he doing? He was also always rehearsing when he gave presentations. So I thought like, okay, you have to rehearse. It doesn't come from itself. He doesn't stand there and didn't think of his speech. Even a speech at the Christmas party. So that's what he taught me. And he's still very active, but we're still in contact, and that's nice to have nice friends in your office. I've been a lot like this picture says more than 1,000 words, I think. From a very young age on, I've been multiple times the only women in the room. And it didn't stroke me as old from a young age. It was just the way it was. But later on, when I wanted to become a partner, then all of a sudden it became more difficult. And it's always also difficult for men to become a partner in the office everywhere, but it's still a little bit more difficult for women. It was at my time, and I still think it is. And why is that? That is because there are simply more men at the top, and they understand the jokes from other men. They just understand men better than women, I think. And I must say that I understand women better than men. So my team consists more of women, and I really have to be alert myself to be not biased myself as well. So that was also a lesson I learned. When I was younger, I never thought there was it would be more difficult for women. But the higher I climbed, it became more apparent, and there's lots of articles on it. So if you're interested in that, it's very interesting to read about it. And in the short term, there will be a draft law that we have to vote on and debate on in the Senate, and that will be on quota for supervisory board members. So it will be interesting maybe for you all to follow that. And it will be, for me, it will be really, really the highlight of my, time in the Senate, because I will be the one for my party to be the, so that will be really, really exciting. Then, yeah, a private life. Don't forget about your private life. That's what mother taught me. So these are my friends. The one in the middle you saw on the picture from Leiden, that's Zita. The one on the left is also a friend from Leiden I lived with. And the one next to that is Yvette, and she's my best friend from school. And next to that is Christine. She is a judge, and she is my best friend from the office from early on. We're still best friends. We still see each other a lot. And they were the witnesses at my marriage, and here they were making big fun of me. So as I started off telling you, I'm also a mother. These are Jurriaan and Nicolaas. Jurriaan is the eldest, Nicolaas the youngest. And as you can see, when I came home from work, the first thing I did was read books with the children, and that was always a great pleasure for me. And what I've learned there is that people always said, well, your children don't go to kindergarten, will there be will they have friends, will they be social? They're always questioning. People at dinner party said, do you feel you're a good mother because you're never home? And then I felt very guilty, of course. And my good one-liner, he always said, like, well, why don't you tell them, well, let's see in 20 years time whose children do better, who are better persons for society and for their parents. So that was a very, very good thing for me, because it made every conversation much easier for me, and I felt less guilty. Of course, you always feel guilty, but I think if you don't work, you always feel women just feel guilty now and then, and you have to learn to go on. I now always say, I mean, now my eldest son is works just got a job at the Brouw Law Firm next to Baker McKenzie, so next to my office. And the youngest will start his master's in September. They're real good kite surfers. They're just lovely persons, and most of all, they're really nice and to have. They're really funny. They have a good sense of humor, and they're both much taller than I now. So in a few years' time, they will look after me instead of me looking after them. So to give you an impression, the first partner meeting looks like this. You can't imagine anymore, but in the COVID times, to sit so closely next to each other. It was in New York, and it was in a big fancy hotel. I was really impressed. I thought, like, wow, it looks like the United Nations. You know, we had big meetings, partner meetings with all the flags and the executive committee sitting in the front, and us with all buttons to vote and to speak in a big room. But then I was never too impressed. I always thought, like, let's enjoy for the time that I'm here. And if I'm not, I will do something else. That's also a good tip. You always have other options. Also, especially for women, ask a question now and then. If you're in a big audience and you have a meeting, don't be shy. Just ask a question. It makes you and that they will think of you when there are presentations. They will ask you. Don't think, oh, I'm too scared to do the presentation. No, do as Merle. Just do the presentation, and you'll be fine. Practice, and you'll be fine. Then the first time I became politically engaged was in 2006. I was asked to join a group of women, this group of women, and it was called Women on Top. And it was so nice. We were always, as you can see, drinking, making plans. We had plans to make Holland a better place for women. We had jokes together. We presented all kinds of papers to the politicians, to ministers. We came on television with that. We were a bit of rebels. Next to me, the tall one, that's Petra Stine. I'm now with her. No, one photo back, please. Yeah, that's Petra Stine. You see, with the dark hair, standing at the back. I'm with her in the Senate for another political party. It's very nice to be there with her. You see Kirsten van het Hul with the short blonde hair. She's in the Tweede Kamer, so she's also a politician now. And then you see Lisbeth, also in politics in The Hague. So you see and in the front are the journalists. So you see that we all, one way or the other, ended up in politics. We had tongue-in-cheek jokes, as I told you, and that's indeed the next photo. So what we did, we made an all-women government. So you see Nelly Kroes there next to Queen Beatrix, and you see all women, and some of the women made it to become a minister. So it's funny but then back then in 2006, that was really revolutionary to do something like this. So people were also looking at us, oh, a strange group of people. But that's a lesson. If people say that and you have fun, just do your own way. And if you are having fun, don't listen to the people who say, oh, a bit of a weird person. People will always talk either at your face or behind your back. Some people like you, others don't like you. And as long as you feel good at what you're doing and you don't harm other people, then you're just fine. Yes, as Merle said, I became I got a prize for best female in employment in Europe, and there I Cherry Blair, she handed me the prize and in a fancy hotel, and that was just nice, and just we had fun, and the others are colleagues from my office and other offices. One of the nicest case I did was the Johan Cruyff case. We represented Johan Cruyff with my colleagues, Mike Janssen, you see him there, and Frank Kroes. And we won two court cases for Johan Cruyff. It was a wonderful person. I mean, we visited him to pitch in Barcelona at his house with his wife, Danny, and it was so nice. He's so clever, so friendly, and after an hour talk, he said, "I trust you. You do my case." We also represented many of the football trainers of Ajax, and they were in the office all the time. That was a really unseen in a law firm, that there were football players in their football outfits, and they were in our canteen, and we had lots of fun, and yeah, it was one of the nicest periods at Baker's. And why was that? Because you were with a group of friends, it was a nice client, and a group of friend lawyers, and you really, really needed to win the case. I mean, it was really important to win the case. There were cameras every court case, everywhere, and if Johan Cruyff came somewhere, the people were clapping in the streets. I had never experienced that before. It was really, something. A mentor, please mentor. I'm not saying be coached. I've never had a coach. I'm not saying that's good, but it's just the truth. But I had mentors, and Christine Lagarde was my mentor. And I looked up to her. I looked at her, how she did things. She was a few years older. She was good fun. She was really a hardworking person, very dedicated. I learned presenting, looking at her. She was also she is still a very warm person. Just nice to be around with her. If the shit hits the fan, she will have your back. She will help you. And she still writes me letters. When I became a senator, she wrote me a letter, a congratulation letter. So I'm doing that now, my turn to other women. And she has taught me things like stay true to yourself, be prepared, work hard, also have fun now and then. So that I now want to pass on to you. And Christine Lagarde, as many of you will know, is the director of the European Central Bank. But when I started, she was an employment lawyer like me at Baker McKenzie. She later became the chair of Baker McKenzie Global. She was in government in France. So she is a really respected lady. So also a tip is, write articles. If you have a job, write articles, albeit for your internal maybe newsletter of your firm. I wrote books on employment law. It makes you visible. It makes you respected. So this was a book in English on employment dismissal law in the Netherlands. I wrote lots of articles in newspapers, just everywhere. It doesn't matter. So that is another tip. I jump a little bit on from the books to the family, but that is the way the photos has been set up. So this is and that really goes to being really, really a lawyer, writing a book, working hard, being in some sort of a bit maybe old-fashioned clothes, to having fun. I've said it a lot. This is my family and I, so the two children, my husband and a nephew at Burning Man. I don't know if most of you will know what Burning Man is, but it is just some call it a festival, some call it an art fair, some call it just that is built together for a week with 70,000 people. There are tents, only tents and SUVs, there's lots of art. You should Google it if you've never heard of it. It's in the desert of Nevada. You cycle the whole way. You party during the night. And I've been there four times now. I think three times with the children. We've really, really, really enjoyed it. Then back to the books. As Merle said, I've wrote a book on, it's called Free Spirited, Vrijgevochten, together with Emma Posma. She's on the photo. Emma is a very young girl. She was doing journalism, studying journalism. I was called by the Prometheus, why don't you write a book? And I thought like, okay, maybe it's nice to do that together with Emma. Emma and I sat for hours at this same kitchen table. We wrote together. I told her story. She wrote things. So it was really a joint effort, and it's a really easy written book. It's fun, it's nice, and I'm very grateful to her. And the book launch was in the Rijksmuseum, and where Hendrik Grebolder, one of my former friends of Rapenburg 120, is in the board of the Rijksmuseum now. Then stepping out of your comfort zone, it's back there again. I've said it many times. You can step out of your comfort zone on many angles. So write a book, write an article, give a presentation. Say when there is something people ask, I sometimes ask, who want to be take up on a leadership role in that particular area? Women will almost never put up their hands. I'll do it, but men will. So I encourage women, say I'll do it, and see after that you can do it. I'm sure you can, and you'll find a way, and it will help you grow. So I made some of my team members step out of their comfort zone. First, we flew to Johannesburg, my whole team. We gave a seminar in Johannesburg for our big clients, together with our Johannesburg friends and colleagues. Then we hired cars and tents, and we had a team outing to Africa Burn. Some of my teammates said, oh, but do I have to sleep in a tent on the roof of a car? I can't shower for four nights. I don't know how to do that. I don't like that. I want to be in a nice hotel and lay at the pool. And so it was a bit of a risk I took. I asked Baker McKenzie. It's all about inclusion. It's about leave no trace. So it all is a very good for a very good cause, and they all want to go back to Africa Burn. They enjoyed it immensely. It made our team bond all the stronger, and we talk about it every day. Especially because this team outing was just before COVID did hit the world. Then do something extra. Yes, I've always done something extra from a young age. I've been in many, many boards, small boards. Boards sound very heavy, but you can do small things for the community, for society. You can do whatever. Be in a board for the gardens at the Zuidas. I mean, that's what one of my teammates now is doing. Do something in music for children, what another teammate's doing now. So I'm a board member of African Parks because, as you all will know now, Africa is dear to my heart. You meet lots of people, you see other angles, and it will also bring you further. It will bring you work, it will bring you fun. So it's nice to do that. So where am I now? The last photo. Where am I now? I've said it a lot. I'm now in the Senate. I'm still at Baker McKenzie, working hard in Baker McKenzie for my clients. I love my clients. I love my job. I love employment law. I really love my team, and to steer the team in the right direction and be together. But what's new for me, and when I stepped out of my comfort zone, was when I went to the scouting committee of my VVD, the party I'm a member of, and said, here I am, this is what I can bring to the table, and I would like to do something for the VVD. I went to the high potential class. You had to do class for several weekends. My husband was laughing at me. He said, you act as if you're not doing enough already, but I enjoyed it. There I am at my maiden speech. That is Minister Dekker. I'm a lot debating with him on justitie en veiligheid. That is one of my I'm the spokesperson for that. And as you see, there is Willem Stevens. he's a bit older, I'm a bit older, but we're still going strong. And there you see me elbowing. It was the first time we elbowed. It was in March last year. And that is the chair of our of the Senate, Jan-Antoni Bruin, who also became a good friend. So I'll stop it there. I hope you enjoyed it. Maybe Merle has some questions, or you have some questions.
Yes.
And I don't hope I talk too much or too
long.
No,
definitely not. Thank you for sharing your story and all the things you learned in the years of experience that you have. So we have a couple of questions. I saw that, let me just have a quick look. So Helen is asking, how and where can you find a good mentor?
Yes, that is a good question. A mentor, what I did is look in I don't know if Helen is already in a working environment or still a student, but I'll answer the question either way. So if you're in a working environment, if you work, then I would look around at work. Do you have a click with someone? Do you see someone that you think, ooh, that is something I think I could never do? So you would never think, but it's true. I was a little bit shy. So I was really stressed out when I had to give presentations when I was younger. And then I saw Willem Stevens and he was not shy at all. And I thought, oh, that's just the talent he has, you know. He's just born to be a good speaker. And I asked him and he said, no, I've learned that and I practice. And he was very old. He became my mentor a little bit. So that would be my tip at work. Look at people you think, ooh, he can do something or she can do something I can't.
Yeah.
Then if you're in a student, you can ask a teacher or someone you live with in a student house who's a little bit older, but also be bold. If you admire someone either from television or in politics, or just send an email. Just send an email. I admire you. I would like to talk with you for 10 minutes in 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Someone can always squeeze in 10 minutes.
Sounds like a really good idea.
Okay.
So yeah, let me look at some other questions. So Pauline is asking, is there any challenge in your career that stands out, and how did you overcome that challenge?
Yes. So I together with one of my friends and partners, we were running to become a partner together.
Yeah.
So male, female, same age. There was room for both of us. So it was not a matter either or. So there was room for both of us. And he made partner, I didn't make partner. There was no explanation whatsoever for myself in my right mind. I mean, he was good, but I was good. Maybe I was even better. No, I don't know. But we were as good. And so what I did then, I really thought, now I have to stand up for myself. So what I did, I found, sorry, I haven't. A hip and trendy earring, but it hurts, so I have to take it out. You can't see it anyway because I have to that.
No worries.
But so then I had job interviews at other firms. I had an offer to become a partner at another firm, and then I went to the board. I said, "You either make me a partner, or I will leave." And then I was made a partner. So sometimes you just have to do that.
Have to demand what you want to achieve.
Yeah. And find an alternative. Have something in the back pocket.
Yeah. So you can tell them that you could also leave if you want to.
Yeah. And also in your mind. Be always free in your mind. There's more ways. I mean, there's not only one job you can do. There's so many, much out there. As long as you think, it will make you feel stronger and you'll be better in negotiations.
Okay, and then I think we have time for one last question. Naila is asking, what would you say is most important to kickstart your career as a young professional? Like a first step to take in your career?
There are a few, so I can't choose. Work hard, that's for sure. But for women, also make yourself visible. So it doesn't matter how, and be comfortable in yourself. Just think, I can do this. I can do this. I had a friend, and she said to every job interview she went, she said, like, before she entered the room, I can do this, I can do this, you know, and I was laughing. So I'm not doing that outside the door, that, but I would do it inside. So that's also good. Yeah.
So be confident about what you're going into.
Yeah.
And then I think we'll do one really last quick question. Monica is asking, how did you experience the difference between female and male colleagues? And maybe how did you... how did you work with that?
Yeah, so that is a really difficult question, because when you're young, there is no difference. When I think till 34, there is no difference. I think it started maybe at 34 when I wanted to become a partner, it started. Before that, I would never have thought, if women said, like, there's a difference in male and female, and I would really think, oh, you're just old, and I don't have that problem. I'm young, and it's your problem, it's not my problem. But then all of a sudden it became my problem, and I thought, oh, she was right. So what did I do? I think I became maybe a little bit more like a male, because then they understand you. So if you just sit in your room, work hard, always be very kind, never claim your stake, never say, well, this is not the way I want to do it, and I would like to do this case. So that would be my advice. But it's still difficult. If I'm in a room, it's still difficult to get her to om ertussen te komen. Yeah. Ik weet niet hoe dat is.
Yeah.
And then I asked some friends, some politicians, how do you do that? And then one said, oh, I'm doing like this. Sitting like this and saying, hey! And I say, well, that's not me, you know? So you have to find your own way.
Find your own way. Okay, well, I think that's about all the time we have. Miriam, thank you so much for also answering a couple of the questions that the audience asked. And I want to thank you for your time and your great presentation. So to everyone that's watching, we'll take a quick 5-minute break. And after that, Eline will be with us to teach you on how to pitch yourself. So once again, thank you, Miriam.
Thanks, all. It was really nice. And I hope to see you in real life one day. Bye-bye.
Yes. Bye.
Bye.